Bless, Master.
Blessed is the kingdom of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for the south, for the peace of the whole world, for the ministry of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God enter therein, let us pray to the Lord. For our Father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities, and for our forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Joshua, Ronnie, Adam, Benjamin, Andrew, Thaddeus, Skyler, and Connor, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those that are persecuted for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy Immaculate, whose blessed and glorious name is the Lord, and ever virgin Mary. With all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
For unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Of the Theotokos, us, have mercy upon us, keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
All in your remembrance, our Holy Immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady of the Focus, ever worthy Mary. With all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God.
To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For holy art thou, our God, and unto thee we ascribe glory, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever.
And unto ages of ages.
The Lord spoke this parable. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path, and was trodden underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away, because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew, and yielded a hundredfold. And his disciples asked him what this parable meant. Jesus said, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God. But for others, they are in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand." Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy, but these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time the temptation fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. And as for that in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast and honest in good heart, and bring forth fruit with patience. As Jesus said this, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
Training and he is ready to serve, right? Okay. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord our God, we ask thee to bestow thy blessing upon this thy servant Simeon. Today has granted the privilege of serving as an acolyte at your holy altar. We pray that through his service, the love he has in his heart for you and your holy church may continue to grow. We ask you, Lord, to bestow your blessings upon his family, his example of faith and spiritual guidance has directed his desire to serve at thy holy altar. Grant peace and continued well-being. Preserve thy servant uncondemned in all things, so that through service as an acolyte he may continue to glorify thy blessed kingdom, both on earth during liturgy and unto eternity in heaven. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Because the sower is not merely interested in growing plants. He's ultimately after fruit. He's after the produce, the harvest, that which the plant provides. The sower who grows a field full of lovely plants that are barren and without fruit is not going to be a happy man.
And so the point of sowing is not just to grow or produce, but to be fruitful. And the same, you know, is true with God, excuse me, the great sower. He sows his word in the hope not simply of producing Christians, of bodies to fill the churches, but of producing Christians who will bear much fruit. God wants his people to be fruitful and not barren of the fruits of the Spirit. A church full of people who do not bear fruit, who are not filled with the Spirit, is a failed crop. You know, that's these stories come to us many times in the Gospel. The story of the field that's got weeds and good plants growing together. And sometimes we think full churches are a good thing, and I suppose they are. But there's no guarantee that all the plants in those churches are fruitful. The fruit of the Spirit, as we know, love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, only to name a very few. These are just some that St. Paul mentions. Christians are to nurture the seeds of faith and the Word of God within themselves to produce a bounty of such fruit in their lives. If we have not love, if you are not joyful, if you are without peace, if you are impatient, if you are unkind to others, if you are lacking in repentance and so on, you know, you have good reason to doubt whether you are being fruitful. We are often so lenient with ourselves, though we are often strict with others, but lenient in terms of, you know, oh, one day I'm going to get it together, one day I'm going to repent, and so forth. One day I'll have love, mercy, kindness, forgiveness, but just not yet. It doesn't fly that way. And if we have any sort of doubt, and I think we should pay attention to this gospel lesson, because that's why our Lord gave it. It is for people like us. It is not for the other guys, or somebody else, or your neighbor, or the guy sitting next to you. It is for you that this parable is delivered. And it shows God loves us, first of all. Shows God knows the troubles that we often have getting a good harvest out of the soil of our hearts. And he provides us with, I don't know, what gardening tips on how to produce a good crop. So let's consider this parable. And first, the seeds that are sown, because they may not be exactly what we imagine. Jesus called them the Word of God. But he wasn't talking about the Bible. Everybody seems to assume that, you know, these days. But it couldn't have been that's what he's talking about, because the Bible, as we know, didn't exist in those days. It took centuries for it to be canonized and put together, and, you know, 1,500 years for the printing press to be invented. So, and in addition to that, if he was strictly speaking about the Scriptures, then what about the millions and perhaps billions of people who had never read the Scriptures, never been exposed to them? Did somehow the sower neglect these folks? The seeds didn't quite reach that far. No. I would posit that the Word of God is Jesus Christ himself. This is what he's referring to when he says the Word of God. Also, the whole self-revelation of God is what he means by the Word of God, which also is Jesus Christ. This self-revelation goes to every man. Jesus stands at the door of every man's heart and knocks, seeking entry. And although the church is the ark of salvation and contains the fullness of God's self-revelation, the love and grace of God is by no means limited to the church alone. This doesn't mean I'm a universalist, I'm not. But it means I do believe that the Word of God, speaks to every man on earth in some way. Even the man, you know, picture the most remote jungle or what have you, the man who has never heard the name of Jesus Christ spoken to him by another man, can still hear Jesus Christ speak to him in his heart. you know, it is possible for the Lord to reach us. This is the love of God at work. It doesn't negate anything that we have here or anything that we support or put forth in the church. There is a place where there is the fullness. But God operates also for all men, for all, he loves all, for he desires that all men be saved. And you know what? God, in his great mercy, even speaks to us, even to us Christians, even to us who are snugly and perhaps smugly in the church. In fact, he may actually need to speak a little louder to us, since surrounded as we are by so many churchy things, we may have grown a little immune to the message and a little hard of hearing. We may in fact be like one or more of the soils in today's gospel lesson, but that's something that we should think about. Because again, our Lord gave us this, and he spoke to us, not to others only, but to us. You know, I keep saying that because there are people, Christian people, in fact, a lot of Christian people who teach today that Jesus' words are not for Christians. You know, when he talks about, oh, the way is narrow and the gate is difficult, that's not for Christians. You know, we've already found that narrow gate, they say. So that's for the unbelievers. The Beatitudes, Matthew 25, the Great Judgment. This, all of this is not for Christians. It's for pre-Christians. This is what people teach. And I think that that's really convenient. That, golly, you know, I can read these troubling words of Jesus and not pay attention to them because they're not for me. They're for the other guy. But that's really not the way it works. I mean, our Lord does speak to us, and we should pay attention to his lessons, even his parables, because we are the different kinds of soil, I think, at different times. And sometimes, you know, we may be the hard path. Remember the path, people rushing back and forth, a hard, you know, it's tapped down by the feet of many, and the seeds sort of bounce around, they get trod underfoot by men, they're neglected, they're ignored, and eventually the birds come and snatch them away, or the demons, as our Lord said. God may speak to us over and over again in our life about this thing or that thing. He may direct us toward repentance. He may encourage us to do something that we need to do that we're not doing. And maybe we just don't listen. Or maybe we're too busy until perhaps the demons come and snatch away God's revelation to us. We should take this seriously. We should learn to kind of be a little more tender-hearted and listen to us. Listen when God speaks to us. Sometimes, perhaps, we are that rock, that hard, rocky ground that's covered by just a little bit of dirt, just enough that the seedlings fall in and start to grow. But their tiny little delicate roots can penetrate into that hard heart, and they wither and they die. Are we unwilling to listen to God or to change, to do the things that we need to do? Do we ignore calls for repentance? Do we ignore godly counsel? Do we ignore even the penance given to us? I just love it when people tell me, you know, I didn't take the advice you gave me in confession. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. First of all, I don't give advice in confession. I give penance. There's a difference, you know. Advice you can take or leave. Penance you have to obey. But, you know, we don't have that mindset. I am the ruler of all things. And we forget that, or we just don't want to face it. Which is why a lot of people don't go to confession at all, because they're afraid they might be given some penance that they don't want to do. This is not good. This is not good. You can't live your way around God. There's no work around when it comes to the eternal. We really have to learn to be more obedient, to be softer of heart. And we certainly don't want to be the thorn people. You know, it sounds like some 1950s horror movie. Seeds that fall amongst the thorns, in the midst of so many cares and concerns and pleasures and distractions. We're simply too busy with a life too full to produce a crop for God. Or maybe we are the well-intentioned folks who really would like to give more attention to spiritual things if we just had the time. You know, what's the number one reason we say that we don't pray in the mornings? I just don't have the time. I got up too late, or the kids are crying, or my husband is crying, or... and I don't even have a husband. I don't know how that happens. Or are we the good soil, holding fast the word of God in an honest and good heart, and bringing forth fruit with patience? And I say again, to be honest, there's probably a little bit of each kind of soil in us. We went to Home Depot and bought the mixed pack. At times, we may have some rocks. We may be hard and impenetrable, stuck in our own way and unwilling to listen to God. Much of the time, really most of the time, I dare say, we're too busy, we're too distracted, or too focused on other things to make time for God. Sometimes temptations and a stubborn lack of repentance rob us, like the demons coming and stealing away from us. And sometimes the word finds the good soil, and it nestles down in there, and it bears good fruit if we possess the patience to nurture it and to not give up. You know, Christianity requires patience. Christianity is hard, and it's so easy to settle for something not so hard, right? I mean, we might be enthusiastic at times, we want to come to church, we want to pray, we want to fast, we want to do all of it, and then it's like, oh man, that's a lot of work. And so we just come to church, we don't do anything, and we neglect any kind of struggle. That's one kind of soil. I don't think it's the one that we want to encourage. I think these are all good points from our gospel lesson this morning that we should ponder. But that's assuming that we want the word of God to enter into our hearts, to take root there. God wants us to be fruitful and to show forth in our life the abundance of his graces. If we neglect this work, then quite frankly, we miss the whole reason for our existence. You know, we have no other purpose except to be fruitful. We don't want to be a field full of barren plants. We want to be God's fruitful vineyard, if you will. And we pray that we always love God. We always love and receive his word into us. And that we together may bear much fruit. The glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us. Keep us, O God, by thy grace, wisdom.
That pardon always by thy might we may ascribe glory unto thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Thank you. For the President of the United States and all civil authorities and our armed forces everywhere, the Lord God remember them in His kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Orthodox servants of God, especially for the Archpriest Wayne and for Freeland, for Kevin and his family, for Claire, James, Michelle, Autumn, Aubrey, Lauren, Maggie, Claire, Christina, Mary, Stacy, they may have mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, pardon, and remission of their sins. The Lord God remember them in His kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, especially for Bishop Andrew, and for those of our loved ones we remember this morning, the Lord God remember them in His kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Thy all holy, good, and life-giving Spirit.
Let us love one another, that with one accord we may confess.
Thank you.
which have come to pass for us. The cross, the grave, the resurrection on the third day, the ascension into heaven, the session at the right hand, and the second and glorious heaven. Thine own, we offer unto thee, in behalf of all and for all.
Savior Jesus Christ be with you all.
Holy to remembrance all the saints, in peace, let us pray to the Lord. sanctified. Let us pray to the Lord. Our God, who loveth mankind, receiving them upon his holy, heavenly, and ideal altar, for an order of spiritual fragrance, will send down upon us and return his divine grace and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Asking for the unity of the faith, the communion of the Holy Spirit, let us commit ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ the Lord.
Neither will I give thee a kiss as to Judas, but like the thief will I confess thee. as a reminder, the communion that we're about to serve is for those who are chrismated members of the Eastern Orthodox Church and have prepared themselves to partake. If you are not yet an Orthodox Christian by chrismation, you may be an Orthodox Christian in some ways, but we ask you not to partake of communion, but you may partake of the blessed bread, which is not a sacrament, that is served at the end of the service.
With the fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.